B12 and folic acid, which is vitamin B9. So we'll talk about the digestion and absorption and intracellular metabolism of both B12 and folate. And you'll see why we're presenting these together, because they're involved in a related set of reactions referred to as one carbon metabolism reactions. And then we'll also talk about the effects of deficiencies of these two vitamins. Before we start with that, we'll do a little bit of review. Again, from starting with some review of things we've covered so far on chrome and iron metabolism. Okay, so this first question, aminolevulinic acid synthase. This is an important enzyme we've talked about. It's important for red blood cells because it controls the degradation of heme into bilirubin. It regulates the pH of the gut, which is important for iron absorption. It can be inhibited by lead, leading to anemia. It regulates the rate-limiting step in heme synthesis, or it mediates the addition of iron to the heme porphyrin ring. So give you a few seconds to
answer that question.
Okay, good. So it regulates the rate-limiting step in heme synthesis. So this is correct. So just recall that this is the enzyme ALA synthase. It utilizes vitamin B6 and it mediates the first step in heme synthesis, taking succinyl-CoA and joining it to glycine to form this 5-aminolevulinic acid. And this is a rate-limiting step. And not surprisingly, it's going to be highly regulated, so it's at the very beginning of this long cascade. The two enzymes that are inhibited by lead are ALA dehydratase and ferrochelatase, which mediates that last addition of iron. So this enzyme, ALA synthase, the rate-limiting enzyme in heme synthesis, it's going to be highly regulated, since it's the rate-limiting enzyme in the first step. And it's regulated by all of these except for one. So 5' IRE, 5' iron regulatory element in the transcript, a 3' iron regulatory element in the transcript, or heme inhibition of gene expression or enzyme localization to the mitochondria. Okay, moment of truth. So 3' iron regulatory. So this is actually wrong. So this is a case where the majority are incorrect. It's actually the 5'. So this is a little tricky to think about. But remember, these IRE elements, there's stumbled structures which are present in the transcript. They can be present in the 5' end, which would be the very beginning, or the 3' end. And that 5' end is going to have effects on ribosome tracking. So it's going to affect the translation. So when you have low iron, you'll have increased protein binding to these IREs. And if it's a 5' element, it will decrease the expression of that protein. And this would make sense for ALA synthase, right? So if you have low iron, you're going to want to decrease the levels. So if you want to not have enough iron, you're not going to be wanting to make heme if you don't have enough iron. Okay, so that would be the 5'. If you have a 3' IRE, iron regulatory element, if the under low iron conditions, when the protein binds, that stabilizes the transcript, and you're going to increase expression of those proteins. Okay, so that's something we wouldn't want to do for the ALA synthase with low iron, right? So this an example of one with a 3' IRE would be transferrin receptor. So if your cell says, oh my gosh, I don't have enough iron, it's going to want more transferrin receptor, which is going to scavenge iron from the extracellular space, right? It'll increase import. These other ones also have 5' IREs, and so these will all make sense. So if under low iron, you're not going to want a lot of iron storage with ferritin, you're not going to want a lot of iron export with ferroportin, and you're not going to be wanting to make a whole lot of heme with allosynthase. Does that make sense? So allosynthase, 5' IRE. Okay, so which statement about heme degradation is false? Now we're talking about heme degradation. Heme oxygenase cleaves the heme ring and releases the iron. Bilirubin is transported in complex with albumin to the liver. Bilirubin is reduced by biliverdin reductase and excreted in bile. And heme degradation is important for the recycling of iron. Okay, so this is correct. C, so C is false. Bilirubin is reduced to biliverdin by biliverdin reductase and excreted in the bile. So if we just recall this pathway, it's actually biliverdin is reduced to bilirubin, which is transported in the plasma. And the big clue here was that we know that biliverdin or bilirubin aren't excreted in the bile. It has to first be modified to this diglucuronide form, right? And that happens in the liver. So we have breakdown of heme into biliverdin, into bilirubin, transport, and then modification into this diglucuronide form for excretion. Okay. Which of the following statements about erythropoietin is true? Erythropoietin is secreted from the liver to control heme synthesis. Erythropoietin has a 5' IRE, which allows its levels to be controlled by iron concentrations. Erythropoietin is secreted from the kidney in response to low oxygen concentrations. It binds ferroportin to control export of iron, or it's secreted from erythrocytes and promotes maturation by facilitating nuclear extrusion.
I'm just gonna write it whichever one's true.
Okay, let's do it. So this is correct. C, erythropoietin is secreted from the kidney in response to low oxygen. Okay, so just recall that kidney is sensing the oxygen levels. In the case of low oxygen, increases erythropoietin production, and this is going to increase the differentiation of erythrocytes, of red blood cells, which will allow the body to better circulate oxygen. So it's functioning as an oxygen sensor. I had a few in here about iron, right? So binds to ferroportin, control export of iron. The one that controls iron would be the hepcidin, right? And that's released from the liver, and it controls iron export through ferroportin. But erythropoietin is sensing oxygen levels and controlling erythrocyte differentiation, which kind of makes sense given the name erythropoietin, erythropoiesis. It's controlling red blood cell differentiation, particularly in response to oxygen levels in the blood. And so let's do one more. Deficiency of which of the following does not cause anemia? So this is does not cause anemia. Iron, PLP, vitamin B6, lead, zinc, or copper?
Is there lead? What?
That is correct.
Yeah.
So lead, of course, if you have too much lead in your body, that causes poisoning through inhibition of heme synthetic enzymes and can lead to anemia. So deficiencies in iron, which are incorporated into heme, is going to cause anemia. Deficiencies in zinc, which is a cofactor for some of the enzymes in heme synthesis, will cause anemia. PLP, also a cofactor. Copper is actually contained within ceruloplasmin, which is required to oxidize iron, and so that will also cause anemia. And then lead toxicity, so high amounts of lead would cause anemia. So all of these can be result in anemia conditions depending on the levels. Okay, so let's move on today to today's lecture on B12 and B9. So just a little bit of background. I'm not sure why this arrow is up here, but we'll just start to deal with it. So in the early 19th century, there is a form of anemia that was described, and it was associated with a degenerative disease of the stomach. This was really curious. Why would you be getting a blood disease from this degenerative disease of the stomach? And in the 1920s, Minot and Murphy described the first effective treatment for this condition, which was to eat a pound of raw liver every day. Which sounds like an amazing, it's nice that you can have like pills these days instead of these early treatments, which are eating a pound of liver every day. And what became evident, so they actually won the Nobel Prize for these discoveries, and what became evident was that there was an intrinsic and an extrinsic factor involved in this anemia. And particularly in the gastric juice, there was an intrinsic factor that was required for the absorption of a dietary component, which they had named extrinsic factor. And today we know of this as vitamin B12. We still have this name called intrinsic factor of a protein released in our stomach. And so this vitamin B12 is also known as cobalamin, and we'll use these names interchangeably. And it's a complicated looking molecular structure. But if we break it down, we can start to see some things that we'll be familiar with, right? And for first off, the most striking feature within this molecule is something that looks like our porphyrin heme ring, right? So this looks very much like heme, having those pyrrole nitrogen-containing cyclic structures that are coordinating instead of iron, as in heme, they're coordinating cobalt. And this cobalt is binding four nitrogens within this ring, which is referred to as a corin ring. And then it also has additional bonds. So it has one bond coming down this way, which would be perpendicular to this planar ring, and one bond projecting upward, which is also perpendicular to the ring. On the bottom, it's connected to this dimethyl benzimidazole. And sometimes this will be replaced by an interaction with a imidazole contributed by histidine within a protein that's present in a protein enzyme. But here we see this intramolecular interaction. This is connected to ribose 3-phosphate, and then there's an amino isopropanol, which connects it back again to this ring. So it has two connections here. And then the sixth position, so cobalt, four nitrogens, this fifth position, and then in the sixth position, cobalt will have a variety of different molecules are attached here. And here we see cyanide, but this could be things like a methyl group or a hydroxyl group or an adenosine group. And these will be important for its different functions in the body, and particularly that the adenosine and the methyl groups are functional forms of this. So this cyanide form, often when we think of cyanide, we think of it as a poison. And this was used in the past as like very aerosolized versions of cyanide. And the, actually, the antidote to cyanide is to flush the body with hydroxyl cobalamin, which binds and reacts really well with cyanide, and it can take this into an inactive form that's able to be flushed from your body in the urine. So that's kind of a cool side note. So it has this coordinated cobalt, and then this additional group up here, which is shown here is cyanocobalamin, the cyanide. So this is kind of a different, kind of simpler view of cobalamin, where we've replaced the ring, the planar ring, with just this little square. And then we have this imidazole on the bottom attached to cobalt, the cobalt in the center. And then we can see kind of these various groups that will change and will influence the ability of this molecule to function in our body. And specifically, we see hydroxycobalamin, which has this hydroxyl group, this 5-deoxyadenosyl cobalamin, and this is active in the body in particular reactions, and then this methyl cobalamin. And here we see that the nitrogen interaction in this fifth position is contributed by the imidazole from histidine within a protein. So that can either be coming from this group or from a protein that's bound directly in a protein active site. Okay. So vitamin B12, in terms of its sources, its major sources for humans come from meat. This would be gathered from that first story where they were eating a pound of raw liver. That's an excellent source of vitamin B12. So major sources include meat products, dairy products, some seafood. In terms of the meat, it's actually coming from anaerobic microorganisms, which these ruminant animals acquire from their gut microflora. So they're acquiring the B12 from their gut microbes. Okay. And then we get it by eating these meat. plants do not contain B12, so they're not a very good, not a source of B12 at all. So if you're a vegetarian or vegan, it's a good idea to think about B12 supplements or other sources of B12. unfortunately, B12 is present in a lot of fortified cereals, and you can also purchase B12 supplements as well. So if you eat Cheerios, you'll get some B12 from Cheerios. Okay, so the digestion and absorption of B12 is a little bit complicated relative to some of the other things we've talked about. And it takes place, there are a few different features to note in the stomach and a few different features to note in the small intestine. So we'll just walk through those in order. So in the stomach, there's the initial release of vitamin 12 from the food matrix. So you're eating this meat, and this has proteins with B12 coordinated within it, and you're going to need to release that B12 from those proteins. And so the parietal cells are going to serve an important function for facilitating this release, because they provide the acidic environment, which initially helps to denature the protein, right? They're secreting the hydrogen and the chloride. And this also activates the protease pepsin, which will start to cleave these proteins and release the B12. And then they also secrete intrinsic factor, right? Which is going to be important and play an important role in absorption in the small intestine. So the parietal cells are playing an important role. Can anyone remind me which cell type is secreting pepsin or pepsinogen?
T cells.
Everybody got it right. If that one's on the exam, everyone will get it. So don't put that one on the exam. So T cells also secrete gastric lysates, right? And we also have goblet cells, which secrete mucus or mucin. So in addition, as the B12 is being released, it's actually an acid labile molecule, so it's very sensitive to the acidic environment of the stomach, and this can denature the vitamin. And so it's bound by a protein called R protein, which is secreted in the saliva. And this protein is also referred to as transcobalamin 1, and you can hear reference to either of the names. For the most part, we'll refer to it as R protein. Lost my pointer. Shown on the right is a crystal structure of R protein bound to the cyanocobalamin. And you can see that our protein has a time in alpha helices, and then it's coordinating the cobalamin in the center of two lobes, an alpha domain and a beta domain, here, right? So it's kind of cupping and protecting that structure from the acidic environment of the stomach. Okay. So our protein bound to cyanocobalamin in the stomach. Okay, this is then gonna pass into the small intestine, and the R protein is actually hydrolyzed. It's broken down by proteases released from the pancreas. And then vitamin B12 is bound again. Okay, and so it's bound by another factor, which we just heard about, intrinsic factor, which is released from those parietal cells in the stomach. And this factor looks very similar to our R protein. It's also highly helical, and it has this alpha domain and a beta domain, and it kind of cups this cobalamin in the center. So they're highly related proteins. Small amounts of B12 can be absorbed by passive diffusion, so just passing right through the membrane. But it's really small, probably like a percent or under a percent. And this only becomes relevant at pharmacological doses. And so what that means is if someone's found to be B12 deficient, they might be getting really high levels of B12 supplements. Taking pills of B12, tons of B12, and this is going to saturate the amount of intrinsic factor that's present, so there'll be a lot of free B12 in the gut, and the amount of passive diffusion is going to increase under these conditions. But normally, if you're just getting it from your diet, most of this is going to be bound by intrinsic factor and go through receptor-mediated transport pathways. Again, this transport pathway is mediated by a specific receptor, referred to as intrinsic factor receptor, or cubilin. And this specifically binds the B12 intrinsic factor complex, shown here. Okay, so it won't bind intrinsic factor if it's free, and it won't bind in B12 if it's free. Okay. And this complex, the complex between cubilin and the vitamin 12 bound intrinsic factor complex, is going to be internalized by endocytosis. And walk through this. So it's internalized by endocytosis. This is occurring in the ileum, okay, so the distal part of our small intestine. It's internalized by endocytosis. The intrinsic factor is going to be degraded in the lysosome, and then the B12 has to be transported out of the lysosome into the cytoplasm. And this happens through the actions of a transporter called ABCD4, which is positively regulated by LMBD1. Okay? And then cubilin, this receptor, can be recycled back to the apical surface. And this is kind of reminiscent of what we talked about when we were talking about transferrin and then binding to the transferrin receptor. It goes through that endocytosis and then release in the acidic environment, and then it's recycled back. This is very similar, with a few little bit different names. Okay? And another thing to note is that this internalization and the binding of cubilin to the vitamin B12 intrinsic factor complex requires calcium. And this is probably because this cubilin has calcium binding domains within the receptor itself. Okay. Does that make sense? Cubilin's binding this complex. It's internalized via endocytosis. Okay. You have clathrin and dynamin pinching off those vesicles that merges with the endosome, progresses down to the lysosome, intrinsic factor is degraded, releasing the B12, it's transported out through this ABCD4 transporter. Okay, so once we've released it into the cytoplasm, it can then be transported across the basolateral membrane of the enterocyte into circulation, and this occurs through the multi-drug resistance protein, MRP1. And in the circulation, it's bound by the protein transcobalamin 2, which not surprisingly looks a lot like intrinsic factor or the R protein, which is known as transcobalamin 1. Right? And this allows it to circulate in the plasma. It binds one molecule of cobalamin, or vitamin B12. And this protein, transcobalamin 2, is secreted by many cell types, including the enterocytes. And once it gets to the target tissues, it undergoes receptor-mediated endocytosis and then it's degraded in the lysosome, releasing the B12. So this type of ligand binding to a receptor, endocytosis, degradation in the lysosome to release the ligand or the vitamin or the mineral is something we'll see kind of over and over again. Okay, so some of B12 ends up being secreted in the bile, but this is very, very efficiently reabsorbed in the small intestine. So it'll be reabsorbed in the, it'll bind to intrinsic factor, be reabsorbed in the ileum, and then cycle back through the enterohepatic circulation. So very little B12 is lost every day. A little bit in bile, a little bit in urine, and a little bit in the skin. Okay, so let's just walk through this pathway again, putting it all together. So we've eaten some, we've eaten our pound of liver for the day. It comes down into the stomach. So we have food bound to B12. We have our parietal cells. They're releasing intrinsic factor and acidifying the stomach, denaturing the protein and releasing our B12. We also have those chief cells releasing pepsinogen and acting on the protein to release the B12. This is bound by the R binder or R protein. So we have this RB12 complex, traffics down through the stomach, crosses through the pyloric sphincter, into the duodenum, it's neutralized by bile. We have pancreatic enzymes, right, which digest our R protein, allowing the B12 to be bound by intrinsic factor. And then this continues down through the duodenum, through the jejunum, all the way to the ileum, where we finally have our receptors to mediate absorption of this molecule. Okay, and this is gonna be mediated by the intrinsic factor receptor, also known as cubilin. In the presence of calcium, it binds to the B12 intrinsic factor complex. It's endocytosed, so it enters into that vesicle, goes down to the lysosome, intrinsic factor is degraded, B12 is transported out, then it can move out through MRP1 and be bound by transcobalamin 2 in the plasma for circulation. Okay. Does that make sense? There's just a lot of kind of different transporters and proteins to remember. Okay. But similar to some of the other minerals we've talked about in terms of its pathway of absorption. Okay, so in the cell, and why is this vitamin B12 actually important for our body? It participates in two really important reactions. The first is in the form of methylcobalamin. So in methylcobalamin, that cobalt will be bound to a methyl group, so CH3. And this functions in the conversion of homocysteine to methionine by this enzyme called methionine synthase. And this is going to be really important, and this is one of the reasons why when you don't have B12, you get anemia. We'll come back and talk about the details of this pathway, because this pathway also involves folate. So we'll talk about folate first, and then we'll come back and talk about this whole reaction pathway involving both folate and cobalamin. The other reaction that it takes part in is in the form of 5-deoxyadenosylcobalamin. It has an adenosyl group on it, attached to the cobalt. And this specifically functions in the degradation of odd-chain, long-chain fatty acids, and some amino acids. Okay. So during the degradation of these odd-chain, long-chain fatty acids and some amino acids, they'll produce propionate, which gets converted into L-methylmalonyl-CoA. Okay. And so we can see the CoA, see the malonyl here, and this methyl group. Okay, and for this to be degraded, we need this enzyme called methylmalonyl-CoA mutase. And specifically, this uses this active form of B12, this 5-deoxyadenosylcobalamin, as a requisite coenzyme. So it requires this in order to function. So this enzyme, methylmalonyl-CoA mutase, then mediates this rearrangement of the carbon bond to form succinyl-CoA. So we see here we have this methyl group, we no longer have this methyl group, and it's present here in this linear chain giving rise to succinyl-CoA. So that's what usually mutases do, they mediate this rearrangement events. And this specific mutase requires scopolamine derivative as a coenzyme. And we know that succinyl CoA can have different fates in the cell. It could just enter right back into the TCA cycle, right? Because it's a TCA cycle intermediate. Or we know that succinyl CoA can also be combined with glycine to produce heme, right? Through allosynthase. So succinyl CoA can go on to other productive pathways in the cell. So in terms of deficiencies in cobalamin, there are several inherited causes for cobalamin malabsorption. There are genetic forms in which you lack intrinsic factor. This would result in an inability to absorb cobalamin from the gut. There are mutations in cubilin, the intrinsic factor receptor itself. Again, you won't be able to absorb it from the gut. And there are forms in which you lack transcobalamin, specifically transcobalamin 2, the form that's present in the plasma. And in that case, cobalamin can be absorbed into the enterocyte, but it accumulates in the enterocyte, so we don't have proper circulation. And so these are genetic forms of malabsorption. There can also be acquired forms of cobalamin malabsorption. For example, in that historical story in which they had a degenerative stomach disease and they had anemia, so that gives you a clue that if you have problems in the stomach, right, you can have cobalamin malabsorption. For example, if you had gastric surgery or removal of a portion of the stomach, or if you have medicines that impair acidification of the stomach, like proton pump inhibitors, you're chronically taking these, this could lead to decreases in cobalamin release from the food matrix and decreased absorption. Similarly, there are many diseases which can result in pancreatic insufficiencies. So if you don't have sufficient secretion from the pancreas, you won't be able to break down the R protein and have it released, so the combined intrinsic factor, and again, you'll result in impaired cobalamin absorption. Okay, so B12 can actually be retained in the body for quite a long period of time. And so sometimes deficiencies can take up to years to really develop and for symptoms to become really clear. About 2 to 4 mg is stored in the body, mostly in the liver. And so this can kind of buffer transient decreases in B12 intake in the diet. One of the biggest effects of B12 deficiency is going to be a form of anemia. So in the last class, we talked about iron deficiency-induced anemias, which is a microcytic anemia. So in that case, remember, you couldn't produce enough heme, and so you kept getting smaller and smaller cells, smaller and smaller red blood cells. In this case, it's a megaloblastic anemia, and you actually get enlarged red blood cells. And this occurs because the cells have defects in DNA synthesis, and they arrest in the G2 phase of the cell cycle. You have the S phase, the G2 phase, and then right before mitosis, it arrests. So it doesn't undergo division, and so you end up with these really big megaloblastic cells, which are the precursor for the erythrocyte. So you end up with really large red blood cells. So I'll just click to the next slide real quick just to remind you guys. So this was kind of the normal progression of our erythrocyte differentiation, in which we differentiated from our hematopoietic stem cell. We had the condensation of the nucleus. The cell is dividing and shrinking, producing more and more hemoglobin. And then finally, the nuclear extrusion, and we have the normal-sized red blood cell, right? And then last class, we talked about iron deficiency-induced microcytic anemias. In this case, we have normal DNA synthesis, but we have an iron deficiency, so we don't produce enough hemoglobin. So the cell keeps dividing until it gets to that concentration of about 20% hemoglobin. It loses the nucleus, but we have these tiny red blood cells. In this case, we have megalocytic anemia, megaloblastic or macrocytic anemia. And this can result from decreases in B12 or folate, which are required for DNA synthesis. And this will become clear when we talk about folate, because the effects of B12 on DNA synthesis are actually due to its effects on folate metabolism. So we have defective DNA synthesis, and then arrests in the G2 phase, and we get these enlarged cells because they fail to divide. Okay, so this is one effect of B12 deficiency is this anemia. The other effect is on is memory loss and dementia, and this seems to be due to progressive demyelination of neurons. And the mechanism isn't exactly clear. This doesn't happen with folate deficiency, so it's most likely due to this second reaction that it's involved in, metabolism of methylmalonyl-CoA. And one hypothesis is that this methylmalonyl-CoA can inhibit fatty acid biosynthesis, and this is required for the maintenance of myelin sheaths on the neuron. So neurons have these super long axons that are sheathed with myelin, which is basically a high lipid sheath around it, and it's necessary for conductance. And these are really long. You can imagine, you know, our motor neurons, which are present in our spinal cord, project all the way to our toe. That's a single cell, and it's all coated with myelin. So you have both demyelination of neurons in the central nervous system as well as peripheral nervous system. Okay, so both anemia and some neuronal defects with B12 deficiency. Okay, any questions on B12?
Is demyelination temporary or is it?
It's not, it's permanent. Yeah, that's permanent. Yeah, it's bad. So the red blood cells would be easier to, that would be temporary.
Recover. Even if
you treated with B12. I don't think the myelin will recover. It would prevent any further demyelination, but I think the demyelination that had occurred would cause neuronal degeneration, which wouldn't be reversible.
On the malabsorption slide, you wrote CBI. Is that just?
Oh, it should be CBL.
Oh.
Maybe if it's CBI, it should be CBL. That's just an abbreviation for cobalamin. Okay, let's move on to folate. So folate is another essential nutrient, and it's also known as vitamin B9. And we can even use these names interchangeably, but most people refer to it as folate. And this is synthesized by plants and some microbes, but obviously not by humans, so we have to gain it from our diet. And the good sources of folate are green leafy vegetables, so foliage. And it's folate, foliage. Same Latin root. It's also present in some citrus, whole grains, and fortified cereals. But it should be noted that folate is often lost from vegetables during preparation. So if you're boiling and you overboil your vegetables, you can lose a lot of folate while you're cooking it. Okay. So this is the structure of folic acid. And this is the oxidized monoglutamate form, and this will be the form that's present in supplements. And there are a few different structural features. There's this pterodine ring with two rings present in it, and it's attached to this para-aminobenzoic acid. And this benzoic acid is then attached via a peptide bond to amino acid. So this is glutamate, right? It's one of our amino acids. And this molecule can exist in different forms. So you can have addition of glutamates to the end here, and you can have modification of these nitrogens at the 5 and 10 position with carbon-containing groups, which are going to be important for its function in cells. Okay, so nitrogen 5 and nitrogen 10. Okay, so this is the primary form that we have present in supplements. It's really easy to absorb this form. Naturally occurring and in the diet from green leafy vegetables, it'll be present more in the form of tetrahydrofolate and often as a polyglutamate form. So in the tetrahydrofolate, it's just referring to the reduction of these bonds. So here we have two double bonds between 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. These are lost here, and we've added some hydrogens, right? So tetrahydrofolate. We can also have dihydrofolate. And then we also have this polyglutamate. So this can be, here we see our first glutamate joined by a peptide bond. And what's interesting about this polyglutamate is it's not through the normal carboxyl group of the glutamate, it's through the carboxyl group of the R group of glutamate. And so if we just look at the structure here, we have the amino group, we have the carbon, we have the carboxyl group, and then this is the R group of glutamate. And so normally peptide bonds are formed off of this carboxyl group. and this is the R group of the amino acid. But here we have this sort of strange or different peptide bonding where it's formed off of the R group, which is kind of interesting. So you get these polyglutamate forms extending 5 to 8 glutamates. And this is important for its function in cells, but it's a deterrent for absorption. Okay, so when we absorb folates from the gut, they're absorbed only in the monoglutamate form. So that's why this supplement form is so easily absorbed. And the polyglutamate containing folates are gonna have to first be proteolyzed to release those glutamates so that it can be absorbed. And this happens through the actions of the enzyme glutamate carboxypeptidase 2, which is present on the brush border, and it's a hydrolase that's gonna cleave off those glutamates until you get to a monoglutamate containing folate so it can be absorbed. And this happens through a proton-coupled folate transporter. So this is a symporter, it transports a proton and a monoglutamate form of folate into the cell. And this is the primary intestinal folate transporter. There's some other transporters in other tissues, but this is the primary form that's present in the brush border of the intestine. And it's also present in the liver. So again, similar to cobalamin, vitamin B12, you don't see much passive diffusion of folate, except if you're giving this in therapeutic doses. So if you're taking large amounts of supplements, you might start to get some passive diffusion. So most of the transport is occurring through this proton-coupled folate transport. Okay, once it's in the cell, it has the potential to be modified. So it can be modified by dihydrofolate reductase. So this is going to reduce. So if you have something like this, this oxidized folic acid can be reduced to form tetrahydrofolate. So these bonds, these double bonds can be reduced. And this is going to happen through this enzyme, dihydrofolate reductase. So it can reduce folate to dihydrofolate, and it can reduce dihydrofolate to tetrahydrofolate. So you think they just name it folate reductase, but it's named dihydrofolate reductase. But it can reduce it all the way to tetrahydrofolate. And there's also an enzyme that can add glutamates to form back the polyglutamate form of this molecule, and that's folyl polyglutamyl synthetase. And so this is gonna add the glutamates to form back that polyglutamate. This is reminiscent of a lot of our digestion. We have a lot of changes, like triglycerides are degraded, and then we bring them into the cell and we remake them, right? So this is what we're seeing here with folate. We have to reduce it down in size to monoglutamate form. Once it gets in, it can be remodified. And this modification will retain it in the cell, because this isn't going to be transported across the membrane. And it also increases association with folate-dependent enzymes. So this polyglutamylation of this molecule is important. And then this can be transported across the basolateral membrane of the enterocyte into circulation by two transporters, either the multiple drug resistance protein or a reduced folate carrier protein, RFC. Both can contribute to this transport into circulation. And mainly it's transported as 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate in the monoglutamate form. Okay. So just remember that if you add glutamates, this is gonna retain it in the cell. So when we look in the plasma, most is in the form of this 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate, so it's had a methyl group added to it. And it can circulate both free or bound to albumin. So uptake of folate from the plasma, there are a variety of different receptors. The liver, as I mentioned, expresses that protein-coupled folate transporter. So just like our enterocytes, it can use this transporter for uptake. Almost all cells and tissues express that reduced folate carrier protein. And then some select specialized cells have a high affinity folate receptor, such as in the kidney, as in erythropoietic cells and some other tissues. And this receptor is gonna go through that other pathway where it's endocytosed and folate's released by degradation in the lysosome. So it has a few different options for uptake into other tissues. Okay, let's take a 5-minute break and then we'll continue. On talking about the actual metabolic reactions that folate and B12 take part in our cells and why they're important. And one of the most important reactions that these take part in is something called one carbon metabolism. So this idea, this one carbon metabolism, refers basically to the set of enzymes and cofactors and reactions that are responsible for the transfer of one carbon groups. It sounds kind of boring moving around a single carbon, but it's actually really important. So it's really important for methylation. So DNA is methylated, RNA is methylated, and proteins are methylated, and this can have a really big effect on, for example, transcription of genes or protein function. Okay, so methylation is an example of one carbon metabolism, and it's really important to the cells. And then one carbon metabolism is also necessary for thymidylate synthesis and for purine synthesis, so it's going to be important for making DNA. And there are three important cofactors for moving one carbon groups. And two of them we've already talked about, tetrahydrofolate, vitamin B12, and we have to get these, of course, from our diet. The other molecule involved in one carbon metabolism that we haven't mentioned yet is S-adenosylmethionine, also just referred to as SAM. And this is a structure shown here. And so methionine, you can see the structure here, our amino acid, right? So we have amine group, carboxyl group, and we have our side chain, the methyl group and the sulfur, so that's methionine. And then we have this adenosine that's contributed by ATP attached to that sulfur group. And this is S-adenosylmethionine. And this methyl is what's gonna be important for moving around in these one carbon reactions. Okay, and then just a reminder on tetrahydrofolate, I mentioned that there are these two nitrogen groups which are important, nitrogen 5 and nitrogen 10, right here. And these can be carriers on tetrahydrofolate for these one carbon groups that are gonna be moving around in these reactions. And there are a variety of different one carbon groups that can be bound by these N5 and N10 positions. For example, we can just have a methyl group bound to this N5. We can have a methylene group where it would be bound to both N5 and N10, be like a little bridge here, right, with a carbon and two hydrogens in the middle. Or we can have some of these other groups. But this methyl and this methylene group are gonna be important for the reactions we'll talk about. So it's just kind of to note these two groups, the methyl and the N5, or this N5-N10 methylene group. Okay, so let's walk through this methionine methylation cycle. And this is how we can methylate DNA, how we can methylate RNA, how we can methylate proteins. Okay, and so we have methionine, our amino acid. It's gonna gain that adenosine group from ATP, right? We have leading of some phosphates there, and so now we have our S-adenosylmethionine, right, SAM. And this is what's going to contribute the methyl group. So if we just remember the structure of SAM, it has this methyl group off the sulfur. It's gonna contribute the methyl group to the acceptor. It could be DNA, it could be RNA, it could be proteins, and then we have a methylated acceptor. We then have S-adenosyl homocysteine. It loses the adenosine, and we have homocysteine here at the bottom, okay? And buildup of homocysteine actually can be toxic. We also have to regenerate this methionine. So how does this occur? And this is where our vitamins are gonna become important, okay? So we've had successful methyl transfer to our acceptor, we have production of homocysteine. This can be remade into methionine, by methionine synthase. And in this reaction, methionine synthase is going to transfer a methyl group from methyl cobalamin. So there we have our cobalamin with a methyl group on the cobalt. Right? It's going to take that methyl group and stick it back onto homocysteine to produce methionine. Okay, so we're regenerating that methionine. And in the course, we lose the methyl group from the cobalamin, and we just have cobalamin. Right? I have that free cobalt there, we're able to bind another group. So cobalamin has to be regenerated to methyl cobalamin, and this happens through a reaction with 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate, where the methyl group from the fifth nitrogen of tetrahydrofolate is transferred to cobalamin to generate methyl cobalamin, and we're left with a tetrahydrofolate, which lost its methyl group. Right? So we have kind of a passing of this methyl group going on here. So tetrahydrofolate can be regenerated to 5-methyl hydrofolate. It gains the carbon from serine to form 5-10-methylene tetrahydrofolate, and then this is altered to 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. There are a couple of enzymes here, I'm not worried about you guys remembering it, so I didn't stick it in here. But just remember that tetrahydrofolate gains its carbon from serine. Okay, so ultimately, serine is the donor of the carbon. So we have serine donating the carbon to tetrahydrofolate, which forms 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. That can donate it to methyl cobalamin, which can donate it to methionine, which can eventually donate it to our acceptor. So there's a series of one carbon handoffs here involving our two vitamins. Okay. And so kind of the key points here, so the methionine methylation cycle refers to this transfer of this methyl group from SAM, and then the regeneration of SAM, and this requires the sequential handoff between cobalamin and tetrahydrofolate. And so the key points, SAM is an excellent methyl donor. Tetrahydrofolate and cobalamin are required as methyl donors to regenerate SAM. And ultimately, the carbon is coming from serine. The basic steps are SAM is generated from methionine. It donates its methyl group, forming this S-adenosyl homocysteine. The adenosine is removed, forming this homocysteine. And then that's regenerated into methionine, gaining the methyl group from methyl cobalamin, which can be regenerated from 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. Does this make sense? It's kind of a passing of the carbons going on here, of that methyl. So we get the carbon from serine, tetrahydrofolate passes to cobalamin passes it to methionine, which can eventually pass it to our acceptor. Okay, so I wanted to mention that the reasons that we have problems in B12 deficiency, a lot of B12 deficiency phenocopies folate deficiency. So when you have a lack of folate, you have a lack of thymidylate synthesis, which we'll go through in the next slide, giving rise to a lack of DNA, which gives rise to megaloblastic anemia. And B12 synthesis, B12 deficiency has the same phenotype because it alters the metabolism of tetrahydrofolate. Okay, and we refer to this as a folate trap. So during B12 deficiency. What I mean by that is when you lack B12, so if we were to take B12 out of this reaction scheme, right, we remove B12, we have tetrahydrofolate, it's gaining a carbon from serine, forming this intermediate, and then it forms 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate, and it's stuck there. This was an irreversible reaction, and it can't reform tetrahydrofolate because that requires this reaction with B12. So it becomes stuck as 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. And so there's gonna be problems, of course, with this methylation cycle, but tetrahydrofolate also does other things in the cell. For example, it's important for purine synthesis and thymidylate synthesis for DNA, but it's all becoming stuck as this 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate. So we get this functional depletion of tetrahydrofolate from other cellular reactions when we have B12 deficiency. So a lot of the reasons why when you have B12 deficiency, why you get anemia is because of this functional trapping of the tetrahydrofolate. And one of the reasons is because tetrahydrofolate is important for DNA synthesis. And it's required for the conversion of deoxyuridine monophosphate, DUMP, to DTMP, or thymidylate. So, and this occurs through thymidylate synthase, and the structures of these are just shown here for your reference. They're very similar, but we see this one extra little methyl group, which is important. Okay, just add it on here. Okay, and the reaction happens through this thymidylate synthase, which takes 5-10-methylene tetrahydrofolate, and this is converted to dihydrofolate while converting DUMP to TMP, putting on this methyl group. And this is thymidylate, which is used for DNA synthesis. Okay. And dihydrofolate can be then reduced back to tetrahydrofolate by dihydrofolate reductase. And then this can gain that carbon from serine through serine hydrolase methyl transferase, SHMT, to reproduce this 5-10-methylene tetrahydrofolate. I think I may have had a typo in your slide, just need to double check that. This should be DTMP. That's the deoxythymidine monophosphate, or also known as thymidylate. And so if you don't have folate, you're not going to be able to produce this DTMP, which is required for DNA synthesis, and that's why you get the megaloblastic anemia. Okay, so the important points for thymidylate synthesis, you have a transfer of a methyl group. So anytime you think of folate, think transfer of methyl groups, transfer of one carbons. So you have a transfer of a methyl group to form this DTMP. So thymidylate is required for DNA synthesis. And ultimately, again, same as with the methylation reactions we talked about with SAM, the methyl group is being derived from serine carbons. In the steps, we have thymidylate synthase, transferring the methyl group from this 5-10-methylene tetrahydrofolate to DUMP to form DTMP. This is then reduced, should the typo should just be reductase, back to THF. And then we have this, there are a lot of long names here. And I'm okay if you just use these abbreviations. We have this SHMT, which transfers the methyl group back from serine to THF to produce this molecule. Right? So we can continue on with this cycle and uninterrupted DNA synthesis. So that's going to be important when we think about deficiency and why we get that megaloacidic anemia and the stalling in the G2 phase. So deficiency with folate is normally due to dietary insufficiency. If you don't have enough folate in your diet. There are also examples of malabsorption syndromes as well, where you're not properly absorbing folate from your diet. And similar to B12, we're going to get that same megaloblastic anemia. So enlarged red blood cells, these are all arresting in the G2 phase of the cell cycle because they can't properly replicate their DNA. Actually, the G2 phase, so you have the S phase, you synthesize the DNA, G2 phase, and then you divide, right? M phase. And so the G2 phase actually have the full complement of two double DNA. So they have double the amount of DNA, but there are tons of damage, all kinds of breaks and damaged DNA, so they stall. And this is classic sort of cell cycle checkpoints. Okay, so they stall in the G2 phase because of the damaged DNA. And some of this is the result of this defective thymidylate synthesis. So you don't have enough DTMP, and you actually start to accidentally incorporate the DUTP into the DNA instead of the thymidylate. And so this leads to continued cell growth without division. That's why you get the enlarged cells. So this decreases in deficiencies in folate have been implicated in a variety of different diseases, and we'll just touch on a few of these here. And the mechanisms of how it's associated aren't always clear. So there's some clear links between folate and cancer. So deficiencies in folate increase the risk for cancer, probably due to this misincorporation and increased DNA damage. And also possible that alterations in DNA methylation may misregulate oncogenes and tumor suppressors, giving rise to cancers. Interestingly, disruption of folate metabolism was also used as a cancer therapeutic strategy. So you don't want chronic folate deficiency, this can increase your risk for cancer. But if you block folate metabolism, this is actually used in the clinic as a chemotherapeutic. You don't want to do this for a long time, but cancer cells are particularly sensitive to this because they're rapidly dividing. Right? So if you impair folate metabolism, you're going to preferentially affect rapidly dividing cells like cancer cells. So folate's required for cell division, proliferation, and methotrexate is a potent inhibitor of the DHFR, which is responsible for the reduction in the tetrahydrofolate that's used in the clinic, and it traps folate as a non-functional dihydrofolate or earlier steps. So this will impair folate metabolism and increase cell death in these cancer cells. They'll be unable to divide. That's also been linked to cardiovascular disease. Deficiencies in folate, deficiencies in B12 or PLP have been linked to cardiovascular disease. And this isn't exactly clear either, but it seems to likely be connected to the elevated levels of homocysteine, which occur under these conditions. And so that's going to be due to dysregulation of that methionine methyltransferase cycle, right? After SAM transfers the methyl group to an acceptor, it ends up as homocysteine. And if it can't be converted back to methionine, it accumulates as homocysteine. And this can have some toxic effects. One thought is that this homocysteine might oxidize LDLs and lead to platelet aggregation. It's also been observed that homocysteine can be converted to this S-adenosyl homocysteine, which can inhibit an enzyme that methylates catechol estrogens and catecholamines, and the non-methylated forms are susceptible to oxidation and tissue damage. So the main thing I want you to remember from this is just that in the absence of folate, you can get increased homocysteine, which can lead to reactive oxygen species and oxidative tissue damage. Okay? I'm not concerned if you remember all of these details right here. Okay, so in terms of just a reminder, what I just said, right? Methionine is going through this methylation cycle and ending up as homocysteine. And homocysteine high levels have been implicated and connected with oxidative damage, so lipid peroxidation and vascular endothelial damage. And the body has ways to keep this homocysteine levels low, right? So we can methylate this and reproduce methionine. And we talked about one way to do this involving methionine synthetase that utilizes folate and B12. Mediating that methyl transfer to homocysteine. Another is this betaine homocysteine methyltransferase. This is only present in the liver, but this is another methyl donor. This betaine molecule has several methyl groups, and that can also function as a donor to reproduce methionine. And finally, the PLP is utilized in this transsulfuration pathway, which can mediate metabolism of this homocysteine down to cysteine, which can be excreted safely in the urine. And so there are a few different ways that our body can keep these homocysteine levels low. Okay? And there are a few connections here with folate, B12, and PLP. And that's why when we have deficiencies in these, we have these increased levels of homocysteine. And this seems to be the connections and the mechanism isn't exactly clear on why homocysteine causes this vascular damage, but it seems to be a real connection. So there are patients with mutations in this pathway which accumulate homocysteine, and they also have vascular defects. Okay, so I think the mechanism is still a little unclear, but it's a real connection. There are also connections between folate and neural tube defects. So under conditions of low folate, and this is one of the big reasons for the folic acid supplementation in our cereals are because of these observed connections with birth defects under conditions of low folate. And so this is spinal bifida. So this is a defect in neural tube closure. So normally the neural tube is in the developing embryo and the precursor for our spinal cord and our brain. And it folds up and closes, and the epidermis is on the top, right? And we have our spinal cord inside. But there's a failure of the neural tube to close in these patients with spinal bifida. And instead, the spinal cord kind of bulges out of the body right here. And it's covered by this cyst-like sac. So this is pretty devastating. And usually, the babies are operated on immediately. Sometimes they operate on the baby prior to birth. And it's kind of debate on when the best case to operate. Some people think they should operate earlier because once they're born, they already have some permanent nerve damage. So possibly operating earlier could protect against that. In some cases, anencephaly is really severe where the brain is absent. So these neural crest cells, which participate in the neural tube closure, have a high demand for folate to support growth, differentiation, and migration. And that's one reason why it's thought that folate is important for preventing these defects. But the precise mechanisms are unknown. This is a little bit vague, kind of like these cells are growing really quickly. But a lot of cells are growing quickly during development. So I'm not sure what the precise mechanisms are known. That's pretty unclear at this time. But what is clear is that supplementation of folic acid can really help decrease these birth defects, and that's why folic acid has become enriched in cereal grains, mostly to reduce these risks of neural tube defects, possibly to reduce these cardiovascular defects. And it's been pretty successful. There's been a 20% decrease in the birth of babies with neural tube defects, which is pretty big number. But it's unclear whether this has actually impacted cardiovascular defect cardiovascular disease incidence. Okay, we'll end here, and feel free to come.